Amen. Friends, good morning and welcome to the house of the Lord today. That song's called I Will Rise. That when we hear God call us at the end, we will rise and be in heaven one day. But until that day, we can hear him on this earth, in this world. That's what we're going to be talking about today, is learning to listen to God speak to us. So friends, we're going to begin with some announcements this morning, as we always do. So I'm going to call your attention to the screen behind me, please. The Cool Spring Corn Maze Trip is today. That's admission is $14, and you pay that at the gate. There's a fire pit also. It's from 6 to 8. If you mention from High United Methodist Church, you get that $14 price if you'd like to go to that. Trunk or Treat is coming up on October 20th, and there's lots of help needed because, again, last year we had like 800 people come. We're going to have a praise service afterwards. The praise band is going to sing for us as well, and we're hoping we get some of our visitors to stay for that. But we're going to be serving hot dogs and everything again, so there's going to be lots of ways to help. Do we have a video to show for that, Dave? So we're going to show a promotional video about Trunk or Treat now so you can get a feel for that too. While they're doing that, I'll call attention to your insert that is in the bulletin about Trunk or Treat. That's in there so you can see there's so many ways that you can help. You can bring a car, obviously, to pass out candy. You can donate candy. You can help just to greet people or to serve the hot dogs or help to cook the hot dogs or anything like that. There's lots of ways to help, and we need lots of people to help. Okay, I'm not sure if the video is going to play for us this morning. Do we have other announcements? Oh. So you can see pictures of the kids in costumes last year. And if you don't want to decorate your car, but you just bring your car, we actually have decorations that we can put on them. So you could just come and be someone that passes out candy. That would help an awful lot. Because again, we had so many people come last year to this, which is fantastic that it's going so well. But if you could, you don't have to come in costume. You can just pass out candy, or you can just pass out hot dogs inside the church or something like that. Ed and Ann Monroe are making their special caramel sauce to go with the apple slices and that kind of stuff, so you can get some special caramel and stuff too. If you come, again, there's an insert in your bulletin this morning marking all the ways that we need help. It used to be just like 250 people, but it made somehow an incredible jump last year, like over 800 people. So we really need a lot of people to help. If you can help in any way, that's greatly appreciated. Are there other announcements this morning in the bulletin or that we need to highlight on a slide? I'm sorry, I didn't realize it wasn't finished. I apologize. But you got the idea. All right, friends, I do have a couple other things I'd like to say then. In your bulletin always is an insert that has like your contact information and things on it. I'm going to try to make a few changes for try to get in the habit of doing. At the top of that, it says that if you could like mark your attendance by dropping that in the plate, that would be appreciated. So, and you can request things on there, like a favorite hymn or a song for the praise band or something like that, or if there's a prayer concern or something. And there's also space on there, request name tags. I want to try to get us back in the habit again of wearing name tags. So actually in your bulletin this morning, and there will be for a while, is a name tag. We have a bunch of people going to be joining the church today and next Sunday, and they don't know everybody's names, and you don't know their names. And one of the easy ways that we can try to say, what was your name again kind of thing, is to start wearing name tags. It just makes us a friendlier church. We do have magnetic ones out there, and on that insert in your bulletin, you can request a name tag. If you don't have one, we'll make you a name tag. But we also have temporary ones that'll be in the bulletin for a while, and then we'll make sure we stock the pews when we get more of those magnetic ones ordered. It just takes 30 seconds of your time to do, but it's going to make it so much easier for people to make sure that we can learn each other's names. Sometimes the people just a few pews up from you that we're going to stand up and greet in a moment, you might not know their names, right? So if you could take a few seconds to do that, that would be great. And there are like pens and pencils and stuff in the pews, I think, as well. And then that insert that's in your bulletin, I'd like to encourage you to drop it in the offering plate each week. And that's for a couple of reasons. First of all, so we can make sure we see who is coming, if we're missing someone in a while. But also, many people now give online their offering, or they give monthly or something and not every week. And it gives people something to drop into the offering plate as it's passed, is that insert. And then it encourages visitors to see, oh, I can drop that in the offering plate, right? And so when we do that, it sets that example for anyone who's visiting, and they feel like they can have something to drop in the plate. And then we get their contact information. If they have a hymn request or prayer concern, they're encouraged to drop it in because they see that the regular people or the members are doing that. So I'd like to try to get into two kind of better habits of just being healthier for our church on Sunday mornings. One is just dropping that insert into the offering plate with any information that you would like to put on it. And second is trying to get back in the habit of wearing our name tags again. It's just going to make us a friendlier place and help us to be able to interact better with everyone else. Yes, Jessica.
Good morning. I know we just talked about Halloween, but in children's church this morning, we are starting to work on our Christmas program. So for my preschool through second grade children, they're all going to start working on their Christmas songs. Even if they aren't able to come to the performance service, that's okay. We're going to just start getting ready for Christmas. And that means at the end of church, all of our second graders are going to end in the Rainbow Room. And then all of the preschool, kindergarten, and first grade are going to end in the library. And that's going to keep going every week until our program, which is the first Sunday of December. So I wanted to let you know, because we didn't get a chance to put that in the bulletin because we were still figuring out details. But we're going to be eagerly singing some Christmas songs. So if you are already in the spirit for that, feel free to listen to our little angel voices singing.
Thank you, Jessica. All right, friends, we're going to be receiving new members this morning. And so out in the narthex afterward, there are cupcakes. Please stay afterwards and have a cupcake and greet our new members. And we're just thankful to have a place where people feel like they want to be part of this church family. God's just doing a great thing here, and we celebrate that this morning. All right, friends, I invite you to please stand if you're able and give someone a handshake or a hug and welcome them to the house of the Lord today.
Oh, thank you, thank you.
Alexander, where's my hug?
Thank you, thank you.
Can we start Messiah rehearsal?
Practices are tomorrow night. Is it? It's
at West Sac,
right? Yep.
All right, friends, as you return to your places this morning, one other announcement Jeff just gave me. If you're interested in singing in the Messiah, we're starting rehearsals at Blessed Sacrament at 7 o'clock. Jeff, I'm sorry, what day was it starting, did you say? Jeff. What day was it starting? Tomorrow night for the Messiah. If you're interested in joining us, starting tomorrow night at 7 at Blessed Sacrament, if you'd like to be part of that. All right, friends, we are talking this morning again about listening to God, learning to listen. And so we're going to open our eyes and our ears in order to listen to God better, see God better, how God's calling us to serve. And so our opening song today is Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord.
Glory, pour out your power and love as
Amen. Would you pray with me, please, friends? Lord God, we do want to see you today. You are holy, and we welcome you to this place. We want to see you this morning. We want to hear you this morning. Give us eyes to see. Give us ears to listen, Lord, as you fill this place today, as you speak to us and call us, as you remind us of who you are and your great love for us, Lord. May we hear you. May we respond to you in worship, Lord, thinking about how we can thank you and serve you in this world and spread your love. As we leave this place, may we do so with our lives. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Friends, you may be seated. Again, we're talking about learning to listen to God this morning. So our choir anthem is also about opening our eyes and our ears to see and hear God.
Just
All right, friends, before the kids come up this morning, we're going to be receiving new members into our church family today. So I'm going to invite those people who are joining the church, if they would come up in the front here. And you can bring your kids, anyone else up with you as well, of course. Some people are joining next week, but those who are joining today, if you would please come up to the front of the sanctuary. Elizabeth, see that folding chair over there? Would you bring that folding chair over here to me, please? Just come on up here and line up here. There's a big empty space, friends. Just come and get up in a line up here on the green platform. Someone's going to need that to sit down just a moment, son. Okay. All right, friends, so we're excited to be receiving all these new members into our church family today. There will be words that will be appearing on the slides now. Dave, there's next thing up is slides for the new members. And so these are questions that are in the hymnal. They've been there for, I don't know, for generations probably. And so the traditional questions that we ask when someone is baptized or joining a church, and then to join the church. So we just went over these, but I'm just going to ask in front of everybody here, and I'll be reading this from the hymnal. They'll be on the screen as well. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please answer, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord, in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, please answer, I do. As members of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, please answer, I will. As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, please answer, I will. Friends, now, members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. And congregation, if you would please read the words in bold print on the screen. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, friends, I'm just going to pass the microphone down the line. If you take a moment to introduce yourselves and just say something that you liked about our church.
Hi, I'm Brent Aspinwall. I really like the church here, that you're really welcoming and definitely do good for the community.
I'm Lisa. The kids' activities are just amazing.
Hi, Denny Thomas. Very friendly church, and I love the activities for the kids.
Donna Thomas. I grew up Methodist, and it's like coming home being back here. And you're very friendly, and I appreciate that.
Garrett Van Burke, just the involvement of the members of the church is really refreshing to see, having been at some other churches where there wasn't as much engagement.
Beth Van Burke, and I think just the welcoming of everybody. Thank you.
Everyone has been so very welcoming, and I feel comfortable here.
Hi, we're the Bowman family. I'm Corey. This is my husband, Jonathan. This is Tyler, and this is Benny. We love all the youth activities. Our favorite one is definitely the backpack program and the softball.
I'm Karen Hera, and I think I like best, I never felt like a newbie when I started coming, and I've made so many wonderful friends.
Hi, I'm Peggy Sansom, and I like all the mission projects.
Doug Sansom, I think we're proud to be members of a church that has such great outreach. We're really enjoying that. And I also like the music quite a bit.
I'm Nick Rubisich, and this is Cole and Hudson. Hudson was the one who asked, wait, my mom's my sister last week? Yeah, our face was a little red. But I really enjoy the community feel. I know it's called Howland United Methodist, but at the same time, the outreach in our community is fantastic.
I'm Rebecca Rubisich. I love all of the children activities and how much my kids have felt welcome here and joined as well.
Hi, I'm Patty Sidley, and this is Mike Sidley, and we just like all the variety of all the activities for all ages. Our kids and grandkids come with us when they can from time to time, and we just like that there's something for everyone here.
Sue Moffitt, I love your willingness to help others out of love and in Jesus' name.
Kay Pajanin, it's been nice to meet everyone that I have met in this church and helping with many varieties of things. Thank you.
I'm Joyce Bowman, and I just love the singing and the friendliness of this church. It is just fantastic.
Friends, won't you join me in welcoming these people to our church family officially? Thank you so much. You may be seated. We're going to have some more who will join next Sunday as well. And so we're excited about that. I'm excited for have all these people officially join us. And now stay up here, guys, because we're going to do the children's sermon, okay? You can stay right here. I'd like to invite the kids to come and join for the children's time, please. Sam, would you come over here for a minute, please? All right, so let's say good morning more enthusiastically than the adults. You ready? Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, welcome to the house of the Lord today, everybody. So today, the adults are talking about someone in the Bible named Samuel. So I have a Samuel with me this morning. This is my son, Samuel, okay? So I'm going to tell you a few facts about Samuel, because this morning I'm talking about knowing somebody and you know some things about them, okay? So let me tell you a few facts about Samuel, okay? Samuel has blue eyes just like his dad. He has his dad's blue eyes. Samuel fortunately got his musical ability from his mother, so he can sing and play the piano and stuff like his mom does, okay? Samuel looks like I used to when I was that age. Not quite that good looking. But if you wonder what I looked like when I was young, pretty much like that, okay? Except Samuel's a little taller and that kind of stuff, okay? But that's pretty much what I look like at that age, okay? Pictures and stuff of us together looks the same. Christian, too, okay? My other son. Let me see. Samuel's birthday is April 29th. That's his birthday. Let me see what else I can tell you. He can play lots of musical instruments. He plays piano. So there's some things about my son Samuel, okay? Now that you know some things about Samuel, do you think that you love Samuel as much as I love Samuel? Probably not, right? Because I love Samuel so much because he's my son, right? I'm close to him. We have a special relationship of parent and child, just like you do with your mom or dad, whoever, right, loves you and is taking care of you, okay? So we have kind of a special relationship, but we have a relationship. So you may know some things about him now, you know some facts about him, but that doesn't mean that you really know him personally and are close to him, okay? We come to church and Sunday school to learn more things about God, but we really come not just to fill our head with information, but to open our hearts so we can be close to God, because we want to try to have a relationship with God. Just like I love Samuel, he's my son, I have a relationship with him. We are God's children, and God loves us, and God wants us to love him too, to have a relationship with him, right? A personal relationship, just like I do with my son or my daughters or my wife or anybody like that, right? God wants us to have that kind of personal relationship with him and love him. So we come to learn about God to church and Sunday school, but we also come so that we can be closer to God and try to love God the way that God loves us, okay? Let's say a little prayer together, everybody. Dear God, help us as we come to church and Sunday school to realize we don't just learn more about you, but hopefully we keep falling deeper in love with you because you love us so deeply. So as we grow up to be the boys and girls you call us to be, help us to try to not just learn more about you, but to love you deeply the way that you love us. And help us to always try to grow in your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, thanks everybody. You can head back to Sunday school. Friends, as you know, we always take a little time in the worship service to share joys and concerns with one another. I remind you that there's always a list printed in your bulletin each week of people that they've turned in these names. They want us to be praying for them during the course of the week. So please, in your own devotional time, lift those people up in prayer. If there are other joys or concerns that you would share this morning, please raise a hand and an usher will bring a microphone to you. Yellow. She has the yellow one, Sarah. Bryn, sorry. Try again, Kayla.
Hello? Okay. So if you guys see outside of the office, there are the boxes for Operation Christmas Child that Jan Rice is kind of heading. Our Ignite Basketball League started this weekend, and as part of their Bible devotion, they packed bags or boxes for Operation Christmas Child. So they did 14 boxes. We have about 140 kids and families in that program, so it was a really nice way to, that's one of the things that we do in our sports ministry is we tie in the other ministries of the church. So we had 14 boxes filled, but Jan would love all of those boxes to be filled. So please make sure you stop out and grab those too.
Thank you, Kayla. So you can still pick up a shoebox for the next several weeks if you'd like to and fill that. Yes.
Okay, excuse me. I have two concerns and one really big joy, so I'll do the concerns first. First, if you could all pray for Jacob. Recently, he was injured during a football game. He dislocated his shoulder, and we found out from an MRI that when the season is done, he is going to have surgery on that. So if you could just keep him in his prayers. He is going to finish out his soccer season wearing a brace, but the football, not so much. So just think of him right now. Also, if you could please pray for my dad. He's had cancer for the past 17 years, and recently we've just found out that it has spread. So he's receiving chemo, and it's just a lot for myself and my kids. So if you could just think of my dad, Jim Clyde, we would really love that.
Lena, I apologize. What was his name again?
Jim Clyde.
Please keep Jim in your prayers as well.
Yes. And my big joy, a lot of you have been praying for my cousin's daughter, PK, Penelope Kate, and she's in a trial study in Michigan, and we just found out that her tumor has decreased 15%. So please keep those prayers coming for them. Thank you.
Thank you, Lena. And so that's Penelope. Her name has been on our prayer request list for some time as she deals with that. So please continue to keep her in prayers also. Yes, in the
Hi.
Back.
I just want to have a joy. My oldest son is here today for the weekend, Ron.
Welcome. Nice to have you here. He's coming to you, John, on the side here.
Thank you. Big joy was yesterday we did Soup Kitchen at St. Vincent de Paul, and we had many youth and many adults at help, and we're so blessed with that. We served 327 carry-out meals, and you know it was just a great, beautiful day and beautiful time in the kitchen and preparing those meals. So thank you to all that participated.
So thanks to all who helped with that. As a way, if you haven't heard of that, you'd like to be involved, they help once a month. They serve, it hits 327. It's usually a number like that, so many people that need help. Some of the ways you can help behind the scenes if you would like to. Are there others this morning, joys or concerns to share? All right, friends, if not, as we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning, from the ground is going to come forward and lead us in a song called Word of God Speak. Again, we're talking about learning to listen to God's voice today. The story of Samuel is about learning to listen to God's voice. And so the song, Word of God Speak, is about inviting God to speak to us as we try to listen. Word of God Speak.
Myself at a loss for words, but the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, I hear your voice. Finding myself at a loss for words, but the funny thing is, it's okay.
Friends, would you join with me, please, for a moment of silent prayer as we come to our God together in prayer today. Lord God, we just sung one of my favorite songs together. Word of God, speak. It's okay when we find ourselves at a loss for words when we're in your presence, because it's not about us speaking. We always try to fill voids with our sound, Lord, with our voices, but sometimes we need to learn just to listen to you speaking to us, to feel you tugging at our heartstrings, trying to get our attention sometimes. Call our attention to something in this world that you long for us to see, to take note of, someone that needs our help, someone that needs our prayers, somewhere in this world that needs your love to be poured out from us into this world. So speak to us, God, and give us ears to listen. Help us to open our eyes, to open our hearts, to open our ears, to open ourselves completely, Lord, so that you, the Word of God, might speak to us what you need for us to hear, where you long for us to go, how you want us to serve and help others and spread your love. And Lord, we know that that happens when we ourselves are filled with your love, when we are close to your heart. So we come this morning, Lord, before you to worship you, to open ourselves to be filled by your Spirit. So when we leave this place and go out in the world, that Spirit can overflow from us wherever you send us, wherever you lead us to go, and we hear your voice sending us into this world to serve. Lord, this morning, we pray also for the people that we've mentioned today who need the touch of your healing hand. Pray for Jacob Holloway, Lord, as he recovers. Let your healing hand be upon him and upon Jim as well, Lord. Lord, be with him and be with the doctors and nurses and all who are caring for Jim. Continue to pray for Penelope, Lord, and for all those on our prayer request list. Let the touch of your healing hand be upon those who need it, with the strength and comfort of your Holy Spirit. Be with those who are mourning right now. Father, we continue to pray for the victims of this hurricane and any of those around the globe, Lord, who have suffered loss in some way from disaster or from war in Ukraine or places like that, Lord. Lord, wherever an outpouring of your love is needed, we pray that your people around the world will somehow be an answer to prayer. May we remember, Lord, that what we put in the offering plate is combined with people all around the world, Lord, to provide help and relief to people in their time of need, to help in ways that we don't even begin to understand how far what we give goes to spread your love. So, Lord, take what we give and use it, Lord, to magnify you, to help others to spread your love. And use us, Lord, to do the same. And Father, we pray all these things together in the powerful name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, our Lord Jesus said that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We will worship God at this time for the offering of our hearts and our treasures. And as we do so, as our offertory this morning, from the Grounded and our liturgical dance team are going to lead us in a song called Reckless Love.
Thank you. you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down coming after me.
Would you pray with me, please? Lord, with grateful hearts for all you've blessed us with, we present this offering to you this morning. Please take it and use it to spread your love in this world to someone who needs to know that you and your love are real. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Ken and Elizabeth, in the interest of time, I'm going to skip the next hymn as it's already 11:20 and we still have communion to go. So, Dave, I'll be skipping the next hymn and moving on to the message for this morning. So, I preached on Samuel, this passage, many years ago, actually, and I gave you 20 amazing facts, and many of you were not part of the church then, actually, so I'm going to repeat those same facts for you today. As a former high school teacher, I believe education is very important, so I'm going to share some facts with you in just a moment. Before we do so, would you please pray with me and for me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So I shared some facts about Samuel with the kids earlier. You know, I'm talking about facts today, about what it means to really know something. I'm going to show some facts to you today. They'll be on the slides this morning. You're going to see the first one here. We'll just go through them one by one. Here's the first one. It's a blank screen. I'd like to call your attention to this fact. The screen goes blank sometimes. Here we go. First fact, the ostrich's eye is larger than its brain. Isn't that interesting? An ostrich's eye is larger than its brain. Whiteout was invented by the mother of the monkeys, Michael Nesmith. You probably don't even use whiteout anymore, right? Some of you don't even know what it is. A pregnant goldfish is called a twit. So if you ever called someone a twit before, you actually called them a pregnant goldfish, if you did not know that. In England, the Speaker of the House is not allowed to speak. I often wish that was the rule in America, friends. I got to tell you, Democrat, Republican, doesn't matter. I just wish that was the rule sometimes here, too. To escape the grip of a crocodile's jaws, push your thumbs into its eyeballs. It will let you go instantly. I may have just saved your life. Okay? I may have just saved your life. Frank Sinatra never owned a pair of Levi's. Bet you did not know that, but it's true. If a cat falls off the seventh floor of a building, it has about a 30% less chance of surviving than a cat falling off the 20th floor. It takes about 8 floors for a cat to realize what is happening, relax, and correct itself. Now, don't try this on your own to see if it's true, but it's true. Next, a mathematical wonder. 111,111,111 multiplied by itself gives the result 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Try it on your calculators and you'll see. Next, no word in the English language rhymes with month, orange, silver, or purple. Try it. Durple, purple, nothing. Canada is an Indian word meaning big village. Bet you didn't know that. The term the whole nine yards came from WW2 fighter pilots in the South Pacific. The ammo belts for 50 caliber machine guns measures exactly 27 feet before being loaded into the fuselage. If the pilots fired all their ammo at a target, it got the whole nine yards. That's where the expression comes from. Mel Blanc, the voice of Bugs Bunny, was allergic to carrots. Isn't it ironic? The voice of Bugs Bunny, allergic to carrots. A jiffy is the name of an actual unit of time, 1/100th of a second. So if you ever told somebody you'll be there in a jiffy, you won't. Jiffy lube, it's a lie. The longest recorded flight of a chicken is 13 seconds, but you did not know that before. Now you do. The only domestic animal not mentioned in the Bible is the cat. Only domestic animal, the cat. The dot over the letter I is called a tittle. Even if you make it in the shape of a heart, you just made a heart-shaped tittle. Honey is the only natural food that is made without destroying any kind of life. What about milk, you say? A cow has to eat grass to produce milk, and grass is living. So only honey is made without destroying any kind of life. More people are killed annually by donkeys than die in air crashes. Now, what are those donkeys doing? I don't know. It's curious, though. It's a fact. And then armored knights raised their visors to identify themselves when they rode past their king. That's how we got the modern military salute. Isn't that interesting? Maybe you did not know that. So there's another fact for you. Finally, a cat's jaw cannot move sideways. Again, don't try that at home, okay? But it's true. Don't try to force it, but it's true. So there are some interesting facts for you today. You're welcome. I just changed your life. Until now, you did not know the longest recorded flight of a chicken, or perhaps where the military salute started, or where the term the whole nine yards came from, things like that that are interesting to me, but now you know. I want you to have a head full of knowledge, of course. I'm a former teacher. That's why people go to school, right? And that's what I'm here for, to teach people. Actually, I'm here to teach people things about God, things that I know about God that I hope to communicate to others, things that I believe about the Bible, to give you information about the Bible and how to understand it better. And yet, my job is not really filling your mind as much as it is trying to get you to open your mind and your eyes and your ears and your hearts, because when we open ourselves, we can be in the presence of God, and God's Spirit can fill us. As I try to tell the kids this morning, I can tell you some things about Samuel. That's not the same as loving him and being in relationship with him, right? I can teach you things about God in a sermon, but what I'm really trying to do is get you to open your hearts to be filled with God's love, to hear God speak to you. Today I'm going to tell you a story of a boy in the Bible named Samuel. Samuel will go on to be one of the great leaders in Israel's history, a man who walked with God and was close to God and led God's people. But when the story begins, he isn't even born yet. If you're following along, it's Joshua, Judges, Ruth we did, and now Samuel. We're going through the Bible in order. Samuel's mother was a woman named Hannah. Hannah was one of two wives of a man named Elkanah. In the very first chapter of the book of Samuel, we read that Elkanah's first wife, Peninnah, had children, but his wife Hannah did not. Hannah prays fervently for a child, and one day prays and speaks with Eli at the temple, and she promises God that if God gives her a son, she will dedicate him to God. And then she has a son, and she names him Samuel, because the name Samuel itself means God heard and answered her prayer. So Hannah has Samuel, and when the boy is weaned, she takes him to Eli at the temple, because she promised him to God. You see, Samuel's going to be raised by Eli and by the teachers at the temple. He's going to live there. So he's 24/7, he's going to grow up eating, sleeping, talking about God. He'll be raised to know everything that the people in the temple can teach him. And this is what happens to Samuel. He is raised by Eli and the other teachers of the temple. He learns a lot about God. So that's the background to the story, which brings today to the third chapter of Samuel, where our scripture comes from today. When most Bible scholars believe Samuel would have been about 12 years old. I'm going to read for you now from Samuel chapter 3. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel. Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." So he went and lay down. Again, the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. The Lord came and stood there, calling as the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle." Then the Lord went with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. And from then on, throughout his life, Samuel hears God. He hears God speak to him, and Samuel is the voice of God to other people. He interprets what God is saying. And you see, this happens because Samuel grew up then close to the heart of God. He learned to hear God speak to him, and he didn't have just information about God, but he learned to hear God's voice when God was calling him. He truly encountered God and began to know God personally. Up till then, he could tell you anything about what God had done through other people, but God had not yet done anything through Samuel. But after this, he will, with the rest of Samuel's life. He goes on to be a great leader for God's people. He did not know that yet as a boy. He grew up, though, he was ready to answer God's call. But that happened because Samuel's mother had planted seeds in him and dedicated him to God, because Eli and the other people there planted seeds in his life by teaching him about God. He had people in his life who raised him to understand there was a God, and that when God called him, he could answer that call. Now you have had people in your life, maybe from the time that you were little, maybe from when you were older, who taught you that there was a God who created you and loves you, a God who wants to be in a relationship with you. But not everyone has that in their lives. Plenty of people grow up in this world not having anyone try to show them, teach them, help them understand there is a God who made them and loves them. And we grow up in a world where more and more people still believe in God, but don't see any reason to have a relationship with God. They can learn things about God or believe in God as some distant figure, but not have a close personal relationship with God. Centuries ago in Spain, the Prince of Granada, an heir to the Spanish throne, was sentenced to life in solitary confinement in Madrid's ancient prison called the Place of the Skull. The prince was given one book to read the entire time, and he was there for 33 years. The book was the Bible. With only one book to read, he must have read it hundreds of times, as it was his only companion. After 33 years of imprisonment, he died. When they came to clean out his cell, they found some interesting notes he'd written using nails to mark the soft stone of the prison walls. The notations were like this: Psalm 118:8 is the middle verse of the Bible. Ezra 7:11 contains all the letters of the alphabet except the letter J. The ninth verse of the eighth chapter of Esther is the longest verse in the Bible. No word of more than six syllables can be found in the Bible. These are just a few of the things that he wrote. In 33 years alone with the Bible, he learned all kinds of facts, all kinds of maybe pointless trivia about the Bible, like the 20 facts I told you earlier, but he left no writing behind to let us know if he'd ever actually accepted Christ or been spiritually moved by any of the passages. He might have known more about the Bible than we could ever imagine, but we don't know if he had a personal relationship with Christ or not. I started the sermon by telling you some silly facts mixed with some interesting ones. They were all true, all facts, but they're really just for entertainment to illustrate this point to you. It seems hard to believe in actual truth in this world anymore, right? Election's coming up next month, and one person's truth is another person's lie, right? Depending on how the lens is that they see the world. But I try, as I said many times, to view the world through the lens of faith and to use faith as the lens that that I see everything in this world and the facts that I believe about this world are viewed through that lens. So here's some things that I believe are facts, even though I can't prove these to you, right? The first things I told you, those pointless things, were facts. I believe these as facts as well, but I believe them because of how I see the world. First, I believe there's a God. Second, I believe there's a God who created you and me and everything in this world. And third, I believe it says right in the beginning of Genesis that God created us to be a reflection of God and his love. We're created in the image of God to be a reflection of his love here in this world. We're meant to be filled with his ruach, his breath, his spirit, his love. Let it fill us and define how we live and love in this world. Because fourth, we were created to love God and love each other and spread that love, that knowledge of God in this world. But finally, fifth, this is a fact to me too. God has given us free will, and we don't always love God that way, don't always love each other that way. We listen to other voices other than God's voice. We'll talk about that soon also. We listen to other voices, and those voices sometimes divide us and set us against each other instead of reminding us that God calls us to love each other. Now, to me, these things are facts. I can't prove them to you, but to me, they're facts because of how I see the world, which is through my faith. What does any of this have to do with the story of Samuel today? Why is it important to understand his story thousands of years later? Because just like God spoke to Samuel thousands of years ago, just like God called Samuel, God still calls each one of us today. And just like Samuel had to learn when he was a boy, we have to learn to listen to that call. I believe God calls each one of us, and some of us do learn to listen, but some never do. Jesus says repeatedly in the Gospels over and over again, let those who have ears to hear listen. You know the difference between hearing and listening? My kids may hear me all the time, right? But they don't always listen, right? Janelle could say the same thing about me. You know the difference? I believe God calls us. God speaks to us. But like Samuel as a boy, we need to learn to listen. Eli said to Samuel, tell God, speak, for your servant is listening. So you see, I hear the voice of God speaking to me often. Now, don't lock me up in some padded cell. I don't mean a literal voice like Samuel heard, okay? But I hear God speaking to my heart sometimes, calling me to serve in some way, help in some way, reach out in some way. And you have to. Have you ever heard that someone was going through a hard time and thought to yourself, I'm going to send them a card or make them a meal so they know they're loved? Have you ever felt the need to pray for someone in their time of need? Have you ever listened to a sermon, like it maybe not by me, maybe Pastor Rick or Ken, and thought to yourself, God is speaking to me right now? Did you ever think of church announcements as a time that God may be speaking to you, calling you to serve somehow? Have you ever been at church and heard requests for people to serve at the trunk or treat or something like that, or the backpack ministry or the garage sale, and think to yourself, this is God calling me to serve right now. God needs me to be part of that team. Some people this morning clearly thought God was calling them to join our church family, and they did. Or outside of church, have you ever had a moment in nature where you were looking at a sunset or a sunrise or an ocean or a tree or a flower and thought, God's creation is so incredible, and I am just a small part of this incredible creation? Have you read a scripture or been part of a Bible study where somehow God was speaking to you or teaching you something new about God? Have you ever been given good advice from a friend or given good advice yourself sometimes and thought, where do those words even come from that God just put in my mouth right now? Have you ever held your newborn child in your arms or your fully grown child or anyone you loved and thought to yourself, this person is a miracle in my life? There are miracles. True love really does exist. Have you ever heard God speak to you, move your heart through music somehow? In summary, have you ever felt God tugging at your heartstrings? Of course you have, because God is real, because God still speaks to us and calls us today, just like God did Samuel, maybe not with a literal voice, but you feel God, you hear God calling you sometimes. So don't lock me up in a padded cell, but I hear God speak to me all the time. In fact, I try to have those moments. And in those moments, in those moments that come more frequently than we realize if we try to open ourselves up to those moments. I try to let my answer be, speak, God, for your servant is listening. So let me give you an example. When I held my newborn children, and you feel that incredible rush of emotion, and you know what a miracle your kids are, I listen to God, and I hear God calling me to raise them to know the love of God and the miracle creation that they are. Many parents feel that emotion. They hear that calling from God, so they bring their children to church, or they baptize or dedicate their children to God. They try to raise them in faith to know God's love so they have it in their lives. Whenever we have moments when we hear God, which is like a tug at our heartstrings in life, we need to do more than just hear it. We need to turn our attention to that tugging and listen. Open ourselves up and listen and say, speak, God, your servant is listening. It's the difference between hearing when you feel that tug on your heartstring and listening when you open yourself up. Because I'm telling you something, and I believe this is a fact. Through my faith and my own experience, God still speaks to us today. Not only can we listen, but we can know God more fully and deeply and completely and be filled with God's Spirit. And we can learn where God needs to serve, what we can do, who we can help, so we can spread God's love in this world wherever he's calling us to go. We learn in Genesis that God created us to be filled with his Spirit, to be a reflection, an image of him here on earth. We learn in stories like today with Samuel that as we go through life, God calls us to be that creation. He tugs at our heartstrings and tries to get us to really listen to him about how we can serve and be that reflection of his love we were created to be. So when you hear God calling, meaning when you feel God tugging at your heart, listen in those moments. Open yourself up and say, God, you're trying to speak to me right now. Let me listen. Tell me what you need me to know. Send me where you need me to go. Help me do what you call me to do. And the more we do that, the closer we come to God's heart, right? I said to the kids earlier, I can tell you some things about my son, Samuel. It's not the same as loving him. You can learn some things about God. It's not the same as really loving God. And that happens not just when we speak to God, because we do all the time, God, hear the prayer concerns of my heart. Hear this person that needs help. I need help. Lord, let me tell you my side of the conversation, right? We also need to listen. We need to open ourselves up when God is trying to get our attention. We need to let him speak to us. The song, Word of God, speak. I'm at a loss for words right now because I'm going to let you, God, speak to me. That's what the story of Samuel is about, learning to listen. And we need to do that in our lives to God. And as we grow in that, it becomes a desire that takes over our lives more and more so God can use us more and more and we can be the reflection of God's love, the image of God that each one of us were created to be. A part of knowing God's love, knowing how deep his love is knowing that he sent his son Jesus to die upon the cross for our sins. And so we're about to celebrate Holy Communion together as we always do on the first Sunday of the month. When we receive communion, we remember that Jesus gave up his body, his life for us, the body of Christ for us. But we remember also that we are the body of Christ in the world now. Christ has no body but us. He works through us. So his Spirit must fill us. It must flow out from us, his love out from us into this world. Because we are, when we take communion, we remember we are the body of Christ. He works through us. And so we need to listen and go where he sends us and serve how he calls us to and spread his love, because that's what it means to be the body of Christ, to be filled with his Spirit and carried out into this world. Friends, as we prepare to receive Holy Communion this morning, would you please join with me for a moment of prayer? Lord God, we just thank you for your incredible love that you give to us every day. We thank you, especially you sent Jesus into this world to give up his life for us so that we might have eternal life. And Lord, we just pray that we remember not just that he gave up his body for us, but that today we are the body of Christ. We are the ones called to be a reflection of you in this world, to be filled with your Spirit and love. So Lord, when we worship you, when we're in your presence, when we feel you tugging at our heartstrings anywhere outside of church in this world, Lord, help us to open ourselves up and listen so that we might be the body of Christ, answering your call to spread your love however we can. As we take the communion this morning, remember that we're the body of Christ. May we be that for the world. Amen. Friends, the night that Christ was betrayed, he took bread, he broke it for his disciples, and he said, "This is my body broken for you." The same night he also took the cup, he poured it out for his disciples and said, "This is a new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all the world for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in memory of me." You need not be a member of this church or any church to receive Holy Communion here. All are welcome to receive communion in this place. Now, if those would assist me in serving communion, would please come forward at this time, and then please come forward as the ushers lead you to do so. If you cannot come forward, it will be brought to you in your pew if you just raise your hand afterwards. We do have gluten-free bread up here at the altar as well. Friends, I invite you to please stand if you're able. I apologize that pastor gets long-winded sometimes. He should know better on Communion Sunday and everything. I'm sorry, but I invite you to please stand if you're able. We're joining together. We'll sing just the first verse, please, of the closing hymn. This is actually my favorite hymn, Here I Am, Lord. That hymn is based on the scripture passage I read for you this morning. Samuel heard God calling him in the night, right? God may not call us in the night, but we hear God call us. Sometimes you feel God tugging at your heartstrings, and when you do, God's trying to get your attention. So we need to say, speak, Lord, let me listen, so we can hold God's people in our hearts and answer how he's calling us, where he's calling us to go. You heard as many people who are joining our church this morning, what they said about our church is, I like that so many people are involved and you're doing so many missions, you're doing so many things to help other people and serve others and change the world, and we are, right? It's a great thing. So many people are saying, here I am, Lord. So let that always be our answer when God calls us, and that means we need to listen. As my kids were growing up, they heard me. They didn't always listen. Gosh, it's frustrating. It must be frustrating for God to be trying to call us, and we don't listen. So let us listen, and let us say, here I am, Lord. I will hold your people in my heart. As you leave this place and do so with your lives, may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now, remain with you forevermore.